Oh, okay, let's get started. Welcome, everyone. So this is a talk on increasing productivity by uncovering cost of delay. And some of you might know me from the other work I'm doing, which is on scaling Agile, which is what I do for 14 years now. And distributed Agile is something that I do for, I guess, 12 years. So this is also where my two core books are about. However, today I want to talk about which relates mostly to the book that's here, which I wrote together with Johanna Rothman. And we are at this moment updating it and providing a new version of it. And it's called Diving for Hidden Treasures. Is the name of it, finding the real value in your project portfolio. So cost of delay is the topic. And I brought a little, it can't work if I don't switch it on. Okay, I brought a little agenda with me, which is I wanna first set the context, what I'm talking about here. Then I wanna talk a little bit about metrics. And then about half of the session is the analysis of cost of delay. Oh, and I forgot the most important thing, I guess. Oh, I'm not sure if it's so important, but my name is Jutta Eckstein. I didn't say that. And probably the pronunciation is often something that's difficult for some people. And I'm based in Germany, so that's where this strange name is coming from. Okay, so, and I'm struggling with the cable. Good, we start with the context. So if we say here, well, I'm saying that we want to increase productivity. That means that we need to measure productivity somehow in order to know if we increase it or not, right? So what we have to talk about here in terms of the context, what does it mean if we measure something, first of all? And the thing is, and I can imagine that some of you have experienced this as well already, as soon as something is measured, you can also tweak it. So that the numbers are giving the result everyone is looking for, right? So there is, I'm not sure if I have the right translation because I know it in German, not in English, but it's never trust the statistics you haven't tweaked yourself, something like this. So this is the key problem if we are measuring productivity. There's only, I believe, one way to get around that, and this is ensuring that everyone knows what we are measuring, why we are measuring it, and what do we do with those numbers. And whenever one of these things is missing, then we will fall into that trap very likely that the numbers are tweaked, and so they are useless. So just to give you a quick, simple example, but I have seen that and it still sticks with me. This was the quality assurance said, well, we want to measure the unit tests in that system, right? And so they had a typical QA, like they started coming with their checklists and running around and checking off, okay, there's a unit test or not. And you could really see unit tests went up, really great. So then I started looking at the unit tests. And well, there was a lot of stuff happening in those tests. However, at the very end, the last line was always assert true, true. Okay, so for the ones who are not do not know about unit tests, so this just means the test will always pass. There is no way of failing, and so it doesn't really test much, right? And the thing was, for the developers, they thought, well, we are writing those tests for the QA and not for ourselves. So it was not clear for them or to them what purpose is behind that measurement. So this is really the core thing about being careful about what you're measuring. And the best is you discuss what's the goal with the whole team, with everyone who is involved with that measurement, and then come up with a measurement jointly. So it's like everyone who is involved or impacted by that metric, that they will measure it together, know what the metric is and will measure it together, and therefore they're also happy celebrating it together whenever numbers are getting up or down or whatever you want to achieve here. So that's the first thing about the context. The other thing, which is a little bit related to that, is Well, whenever you start measuring something, it means you make something transparent. And whenever you make something transparent and you are in an environment that's not trustworthy, then that transparency turns out into something that's more like control. And as soon as somebody recognizes that, again, we have the same thing as I said before, the numbers will be tweaked, then the measurement is useless. So measuring something in a not trustworthy environment will give you the wrong numbers. So that's what I have about the context here. Now, speaking about metrics, and I know because it's only 45 minutes, I have to look at my watch regularly. Speaking about metrics, so what do we want to measure? So I first want to point out some things that probably come to your mind as well as they did to mine. Well, this is a good number for maybe measuring the productivity and then knowing how to increase it. So one thing that might come to your mind is the burndown. The most important thing about the burndown is it's a tool for the team and it's not a report to somebody external to the team. So it's a tool so the team knows, can we keep the commitment we gave at the beginning of the sprint? So we said we want to finish, no matter how you measure that, we want to finish that many story points or that many stories or that many tasks. So however you do that, it doesn't really matter. It is for the team to know how well are we doing along our way through that sprint and can we keep that commitment. And so it's not a means for measuring productivity. It's a means for the team for knowing what they need to do in order to get their stuff done. So this doesn't help. What about the next thing that probably you're wondering already why I'm not talking about that, the velocity. Well, velocity actually, and I'm really an absolute deep believer in it, is unlike productivity. Velocity has nothing to do with productivity. Velocity is a capability planning tool and not anything how you measure productivity. And I give you one example, and you might have seen that too. So as soon as you start looking at velocity in a way that it would be productivity, and you say like, oh, the velocity has to go up because, well, you want to be more productive, therefore it should go up. Well, then people would start estimating the points higher. So again, we start tweaking the numbers because it's not really helping. And what's even more critical, and I guess I will come back to this more often in this talk, is we might measure only what will be done, but not what kind of value we are providing. And that's the most important thing. Are we providing a value for the market and in terms of our business strategy? Okay, so what else can we measure? We can start to measure, and that's one of the things that I find helpful, the average cycle time. So how much time do we need in order to have a story from when it's planned, so it's in the to-do state, till it's really done? And this on average, which could also be used as a planning time. However, when the story is really done, it should most often mean that it provides a value. However, it's not always like that. And therefore, my advice here is not looking at only, well, how long does the story take on average from to do, in progress, to be reviewed, done, whatever your phases are there in between or states are in between. But also look in advance at what kind of value will that story provide. And then measure on average, based on that cycle time, how much value do we produce on average over that period of time from to do till done, right? So that's a really different approach, and it requires as well from everyone to look at value before we start implementing something. Because normally we look at only, well, the estimate. Basically, it's the same question that we have asked before we started with Agile. So how much does it cost? That's the same thing as if we ask a team, well, can you do a planning poker on that, and what's your estimate? At least that's how often we'll be dealt with it. And the The more important thing than any kind of estimate is to look at what value would that story provide, and given that, also knowing then what priority it has have, and once we have implemented, delivered, deployed it, what value did we actually deliver? So the key thing here is what I think it was Jeff Patton coming up with, that it's outcome versus output. So it's not, productivity doesn't mean that we create a lot of stories and implement a lot of stories. It means we create a lot of value. And that's the outcome. Outcomes, which is something that will create an impact with our customers within the market, happening after we have deployed it. And you probably have heard that as well. So the typical story that we share is word, the word processor system, that it has like the Pareto rule that 80% of the functionality is not used and we are only using like 20% of the functionality. So the same thing is true for whatever we are implementing. So we might think this story creates such and such value, but we are not measuring it afterwards. So this is related to also Lean Startup, right? Lean Startup, we think about how we measure, so what will be used by the customers, but even there, we are not necessarily measuring, okay, does it really provide that value? And this requires from us to come up with different kinds of tests. So we have to create tests that are built in the story so we can also get the result from the market if the story is really used and if it's worth to maintain and support it over time, or if this is more a cost factory here. So is it really the value we thought of? Okay, what else? Well, cycle time, I wanna come back to this. You remember this? Maybe I go back. So that was the cycle time thing, right? And this is only a part of the truth in if we look at productivity. The real truth comes to if we look at the whole value stream. And if we look at the whole value stream, something completely different might come up. And the example that I have here, and I fear that it's not visible in the back because the color is too light. Well, the thing is, we have a line here, and on top it says it's the work time, so we are working on something, and on the bottom of this horizontal line it says it's the wait time. So nothing is happening. And now if we are not starting as we did with cycle time, well, the moment when it is scheduled in for a team to work on it, so it's on the board, right, like on the storyboard, the sprint board, but whenever that request first came into our company, so whatever, somebody has heard in the market, well, it would be really cool if we would have that feature, or it's a customer complaining, or it's someone figuring out according to the business strategy, we really would need this, that would be cool. So that's the first time, so I call that a request at that point in time, because we don't know yet if it's a story, if it's really something big, small, whatever, we haven't really looked at it. This is coming in, and typically this is only like a kind of a second of a time, and then comes a long wait period. So in this case, it was like a 4-week wait period till we got to an approval, which took about an hour. Okay, and then we have another wait period, which was 1.5 weeks. And then we had 2 weeks where we did something like gathering requirements, more or less. It's finding out, okay, what's really behind that? What are maybe the stories in it? And who would work on that? In which project would it fit in? And all of that. And then we have another 6 weeks of wait time. And then we have the sign-off from the customer. In that case, it came from the customer, so we need to know if it's really what you want. Well, and on and on and on. And then finally, at some point, we are there, right? So this means we have lost already a lot of time here. So it's almost 3 months till we get started somehow, right? So if we talk about productivity, we should also look at that part and not only what's happening inside development. So that's my key message here. So if you really want to make a change here. Okay, so this was the context, the metrics, and I believe now I come to the analysis of the cost of delay. And this goes back mainly to that great book of Donald Reinertsen on flow. Well, the difficulty with this book is, on the one hand, I highly recommend it. It's a great book. There's a lot of great stuff in it. However, I also have to warn you, it's a hard read. So it's really whoever has read, other people here who have read it. Is it a hard read? No, not for you?
I'm an engineer,
so. Yeah, it's a lot with mathematics and yeah. Yeah, it's great. It is a great book, but it's not like you really like that. So it really costs some effort to read it. So that's one of the things where this goes back to. Then manage your project portfolio is what Johanna Rothman wrote, and then kind of our Johanna's and mine translation of that book into like, okay, what does this practically mean is then what we have condensed there in our book. I want to start with the definition that Johanna came up, and I really like that. So cost of delay, the definition here is, it's the way to think about the revenue you can lose plus the cost of continued development, right? And I guess the first example is already one which probably doesn't come as a surprise, but it really strikes and makes that point clear in the best way possible, which is this one. As soon as you have work in progress, so here we measured that, the red bar is, okay, this is all that we have to do, and then this is all that we have in progress, the green one is all that we managed to deploy. So as soon as you do have work in progress, it's a revenue you lose. It doesn't make any revenue, it just sits there. Plus, you have the continued development because it's work in progress. Right, so it's really the best way of understanding what cost of delay really means. And I only can recommend to you to measure that regularly. So what is your work in progress? Because I see too often that we lie to ourselves and we think, oh, but this is done, or that's kind of 80% done or something like that. So this is from a real a development effort that I was also part in, and you see it's really bad. It's really bad. Well, we got better over time. It was much worse here. We got better, but it's very bad. What you really want is like a slice like that that's work in progress and not something like that. However, if you are not like honest to yourself, you will never learn it. And again, remember, if people don't trust in that and they feel like they will be punished once that's visible, the data would look different because we just define stuff as done. So, okay, that's one of the things. Another thing I see too often as well is multi-projecting. Multi-projecting, or even if you don't like the term project, I know there's this, a lot of discussion about that. So even if you work on different products in parallel, you have the same thing. So given, I make it really simple here. Given we have three projects, each of the project will last only 2 months. So it's really short, or you can also say these are three products and they last 2 months each. Okay, if we work on one after the other, we would make the first time a revenue, so thinking of the cost of delay, right, after 2 months, because the first product would be done. And then after 4 months, more revenue comes in with the second product, and after 6 months, again, with the third one. However, if we work in parallel, the first time we theoretically can make any revenue is after 6 months. So we lost already a lot just by working on the stuff in parallel. And for whatever reason, people in especially large organizations believe that if they start with multi-projecting, they will be faster. However, they are not. They never are. And they will always lose money by doing so. And please note that with this way of working in parallel on several products, I haven't calculated in task switching. And for task switching, the research says we will lose about 30% of our productivity if we switch tasks. So I really wonder how much money all the companies have that they can afford that. And still I hear that, well, there's an economic and financial and whatever crisis everywhere. Well, but there's a lot of there that we can just mine and ensure that we use it, right? Just by giving up on that stupid thing, multi-project. projecting and not really doing like one thing after the other. So multitasking is another definitely cost of delay, even if you are like within one product and you just pull out people all the time. Same thing. Another thing, another cost of delay, and this shows, I think, at best, the query theory. If you work with experts on a team, and I see this most often with people starting with Agile, so you will have a cross-functional team, and you plan the stories, but the stories are planned for individuals, because every individual on your team is an expert for something, and of course I know the system that's built, that's so complex that there's no way to deal with that, right? So we have to have the experts, and every expert is like, okay, I really know that stuff, and that guy next to me has no clue about that. I know that this is what we all think. However, as long as we think that way, if we are really honest, we have no control on priority. And I hope I can bring this point across here. So given this example, so we have a team with like five people, every one of them is an expert, and we schedule the stories in, the stories are prioritized. Now the problem might be that here the expert sitting in the middle is the one having a problem because the story he's working on is really hard. So he has to explore stuff, research, blah, 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 and so it takes time and time and time. And the thing is, whatever has been planned in for that guy is queuing up. Now, everyone else keeps working on their stuff. Well, whatever they are working on is of lower priority than what's stacking up here, right? And it's not in our control if we prioritize those stories or if they're important or urgent or whatever. The way how it's worked on that is based on who expert is struggling and who is not. So only if we are able to really work together on the same stack, we are able to really work according to the priority we came up with. So we are really controlling it, and we can steer what we are working on. And yes, I know at least in my cases, and maybe you are better than that, in my cases very often, it's not that everyone can do everything. However, one thing is we can strive for that. That's at least one thing we can do. And the second thing is, well, maybe if not everyone can do everything, then at least everyone can do three things. And everything can be done by at least three people on the team. So in this way, spreading it out, the knowledge. So actually, if you look back at what Agile is about, it's a lot about knowledge transfer, wherever you look at. So if we estimate together, if we have the daily scrum together, if we plan together, if we do pair programming, it's all a knowledge transfer. So use that and not stick with experts. Okay, another thing, another cost of delay, which might sound strange, which is quality. Well, first of all, we all want to be proud of what we are working at. So which means we maybe want to stick to clean code, we want to ensure that there is no technical debts, we want to ensure that what we are building is absolutely fault tolerant, what we are doing here, and maybe also that the system is so flexible that we can deal with different eventualities that might come up and not. And that's good. I'm not saying that this is a bad thing. However, what I'm saying is, well, there are cases where I see it's more like a gold framing what we do instead of looking at quality, or putting it in other words, it's sometimes more that we are not taking into account what kind of quality is really asked for. So we are ignoring what the market and the business strategy is really asking for. And if we do that, then it gets difficult. So because we provide more than somebody is paying for, and this gets us into trouble. So what we have to be aware of is, well, first of all, maybe it's the other way around, making the people who are requesting a story aware of like what the quality will cost and how important that is. So that's probably the first thing. And then if there is a decision for whatever reason that we need not that quality but a different one, then we have to be aware of that and develop accordingly. And although this might sound really bad for you, I don't know, I have seen companies really struggling with that, and especially if you are in a startup market, you want to enter a market, then it's often much more important to have some functionality out there so that people can see, okay, this is where you're heading, than waiting till it's really high qualitative. On the other hand, you might be in a market that's really kind of a solid market. If the quality is not good, then you would lose your customers. So the thing is, you have to know what's required, and the answer is not always the same. So as sad as this is, so there is not a recipe. However, we should be aware of what's really requested. So that's my key point here, and that's why quality can be a cost of delay. Now another thing, and maybe now some people in the Scrum purist field will hate me for that, I don't know. And this is a cost that I'm seeing is about what I call not starting. And not starting is sometimes expressed by using a sprint zero. So people are afraid of starting with sprint number one, but schedule in a sprint zero where they think, well, we have to set up this and that, and then ensuring that everything works together and on and on. And most often, that's not the worst thing. Most often the worst thing is that this sprint zero is prolonged and prolonged. So there's another one, and a zero ABC or whatever, maybe it's still called zero. So in my understanding, what I see the most often here is that people are really afraid of really starting. And just my advice is, well, first of all, you are losing value here, and you are you're delaying the revenue with that. So that's the one thing. The other thing is, well, why not just jump in the water and get started calling that sprint number one, and just ensure in that sprint number one that you set up the infrastructure, ensure that it's working by maybe it's only a hello world and a test approving it, but you have the full path of it and you can measure what you've done in those 2 weeks. So often I think just by the label of the zero, people start to, I don't know, not really trying to measure it and working hard on something. That's the one thing about not starting, and maybe you are happy with that, but the second one, and which is also very well known in the Scrum world, is the definition of ready, which I find is really a very difficult thing. And for the people who don't know that, definition of ready means, well, if we think a story is not ready for implementation, we have to create it in a way, or rather, most often the way it's implemented, it's the product owner has to ensure that it is defined in a way so we can implement that. So that's the idea of the definition of ready. A story is ready for implementation. Now the thing is, the ready for implementation, what does it really mean, or what does a story really mean? A story means it's a token for a dialogue, nothing else. So we are not talking about a specification here. It's not a requirement spec that we are coming up here with, and where we can say, oh, we checked this, 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 and this is not there, and therefore, well, we can't work on this. This is one thing. So it's a token for dialogue, nothing else. The other thing is what I see most often with the definition of ready, that we start again that ping pong game that we know from the non-agile world, which is like, there are the people who know about the business, so the product owner, and here are the developers. And now the product owner says, oh, I really want that story, so I pass it on over there. And imagine there is like a wall in between, so it goes over me. So it's there. So the story is there. And then the developers say, no, 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 that's not good enough. It's not according to the definition of ready. And so the story goes back over that wall and sits again with the product owner. And you can do this for a long time. And again, it's a cost of delay. You are not creating any revenue on that time during that time. So again, the dialogue I was talking about just a sentence ago is, the thing is, if we think that story isn't ready, it means we have to collaborate in order to make that ready. So it's not that it goes back over the wall to the product owner. It means we have to sit together to make it so that we can work on it and not delaying it by throwing it back and forth. So maybe that's the one thing you take with you, and my hope from that talk is whenever you see the definition of ready, please reflect on it if you really need it and if you use it in a way that's really helpful, or if you use it in a way where you are delaying the implementation and the delivery and you're creating more cost of delay. Maybe you're using it in a way that's helpful. I don't know, but most of the times I see that it's really a big delay. And I'm good. Okay, and the last thing I'm having here is repeating mistakes. Well, repeating mistakes, and you wonder probably about the cows. Well, the thing about the cows is it goes back to an idiom, and I first use a different idiom that we are using in German. In German, the idiom says, we can't sharpen the saw because we have to saw. And I learned that idiom in Texas, where it goes, we can't build the fence, we have to chase the cattle. And that's why I have those cows here. So if we run after the cows, we cannot build the fence, right? And that's what I mean with repeating mistakes. Most often, we keep on doing stuff and we are not reflecting. Maybe we do have a retrospective, maybe we don't have a retrospective. So, but even I see that if people are doing a retrospective, they are not doing it properly, like doing just a plus minus collection of stuff, or they are not really looking at stuff like, where is our cost of delay here? So what you need to do from time to time to really look at what's hindering delivery here. And maybe it's the build time that's too long. Maybe it's the tests taking too long. Maybe it is that you have too many manual tests here. Whatever it is. So look at this and ensure you work on that to make it happen, because otherwise you are creating a big cost of delay. And really the retrospective, and I hope with the cows it sticks to you, that's the biggest leverage you are having in order to get over that. And actually, this is also why I have this as the last kind of analysis thing for the cost of delay. This can help you with all the things I talked about earlier. So if you have that queuing problem because you have too many, I called them experts before, but you can also call them like bottlenecks or knowledge silos or whatever it is. So that's something to work on a retrospective. The same is true. Well, maybe we are gold framing here and this is why we are not delivering. Sometimes I see gold framing also something that, same as not starting, it's a fear of delivering. And that's why we keep on, well, it's not quite ready yet. It's well, So of course it's also the opposite. Okay, so in summary, so one summary is you're producing a cost of delay whenever you're not shipping. It's as clear as that. And again, I really think the work in progress is the thing that brings that point the best across. As long as stuff is not shipped, and no matter what it is, so it could also be that you're releasing only every 6 months. The stuff sits here. It's not creating any revenue. And it's the continued development that's going on. So again, it's a cost of delay. If you're not shipping, you're delaying. And in summary about what we talked about here is, well, first of all, think about the metrics. So you have to have a trustworthy environment in order to really know what you are measuring is really some data you can deal with, and you know that you are more productive than you have been before. The second thing is measure the value you are creating and not just the stuff that gets out of the door, because producing stuff is not really helpful either. It can also delay later on. And then analyze and eliminate your costs of delay, no matter what they are, as I already, like the work in progress, most obvious one, the experts, the multi-projects and multitasking, the quality perfection thing, the delaying of the start, definition of ready, and the repeated mistakes. And I was trying to speak very fast, so we are safe for you, and which is even better, what I hope for, we have some time for questions. So maybe I say thank you first. So thank you. And if you want to take a picture of this, there is a link. We created a discount, a coupon for that book on LeanPub. So if you are interested to learn more about that, so that's the link for it. And as I said, we are working on it right now. So when if you download it now, probably you will get a different version tomorrow. But you still get it. Okay, any questions? Yeah. Yeah.
So I faced exactly the similar situation in my last meeting where it was more of one person working on a story for the whole time, one feature for the whole time.
Yeah.
And the scrums were not effective because eventually I don't care what that guy is working on. I'm bothered about my stuff.
Exactly.
How do you, work around such situations that mm-hmm. eventually, because it's like I don't have feature 1, 2, 3, I have feature 1, feature 1.
Exactly.
So in such situations, eventually, Scrum fails because it's more
it
like,
does.
The whole team comes together and work on one feature and then you move ahead.
Yeah.
How do that
yeah. I first want to check, was this hearable at the back, the question, the point? Yeah, I see people nodding. Good. Okay. So the first thing is not the real advice how to get over it. It's more like how you can figure this out very early. And it is you find this out in the daily Scrum. If people are standing there and they are all bored, and if you hear ever so often, well, we don't know what that daily Scrum is for, it's a waste of time, and it really is a waste of time because they don't share anything with each other. And so whenever I'm part of that team and I'm reporting on, well, this is what I've achieved since the last time we're standing there, and that's what I want to achieve till next time, it's meaningless to you because you're working on something completely different, so it is a waste of time. And the thing is, probably at the very start, a lot of things have been missed. So one thing is, there is no common goal for that team. So it's not that we are achieving something together. And it's not that as a team, we have estimated it together in order to learn what we want to build here. And so these are already ways of how to work on that, right? So coming up with a goal and estimating it together, planning together. It's not that I plan for my story. It's at least that three people of the team plan together for that story, right? And then also we work together on that story. So that these are the things. And if you are in the state you are in right now, actually I would make a focused retrospective with the topic on knowledge transfer. So what can we do? And first pointing out, and well, the best thing is really kind of using those classical retrospective questions. What's working already? And maybe there are a few things that you discover, well, here and there, something is already working and you can leverage that and keep on working with that. Then what might be easy for us to implement and change so we have that knowledge transfer? And then what's difficult and what seems to be impossible. So these are, at least for me, often the classical four questions when we have a problem like that. Very good. Cool. Well done. Good. Other questions? In the back. Yeah. Yeah, I have it. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. So you mean how to measure the value after we've delivered? Both. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Okay. So before we deliver, so there are a few things that come together. So one is the expected revenue we are making with that feature, and the expected savings we are making with that feature can be true as well, right? These are the two key things. Then what comes with that as well is like, how does it support our strategy, our business strategy? So this is You might have wondered already why I'm saying this now the third time or so. And the thing is, it's kind of something that was my most recent learning, probably, that for too long I was focusing on customer and market value only. And this is just one part of it. The other part is also how does it fit in our business strategy, right? Because it might mean we serve the market very well, but we run out of business because of that. That could happen. So that's the one thing. The other thing is how do you define that? So there are different strategies. One maybe easy strategy that I used was using just like planning poker, but we used not estimation points, but value points, right? And we had the people who could decide on that. So of course you need also somebody from the technical part there, but it's mostly business people coming from different angles and saying, okay, in the same way as you do planning poker, poker on what's the value that's really behind that story. So that might already be an easy one. Another thing, and that's more what Johanna has in her managed project portfolio thing in, is you could also think of, you have X amount of money, and you can define X, let's say $100,000, and you split that money over, if you will, we are staying with one product, over your stories. And it's not possible to spend the same amount of money twice. So even if you have like $100,000 and you have only two stories, so it's exaggerating, but that you understand the thing, you couldn't have two stories with 50,000, right? So one can be 51 and the other one is then 49. So you cannot spend the same thing twice. So this is one way of ensuring the value is very clear and you are thinking about it in advance. And then after the fact, it's more like how often is it used? And the customer feedback, of course, as well, as you mentioned. Aha. Yeah. So that's a very good point. So the thing is, then the key answer is you need also cross-functionality here. So they need to talk. So it will not work if you have the business working on that by themselves. They have to work together. Yeah. Well, is that true? I see that. Oh, it would be like 1 minute. Okay. So is it a quick question? Otherwise, we take it offline. Okay. Thank you very much.